The process of creating a historically accurate 18th century ensemble is a lengthy process. Let's take a look at sewing all the garments needed for this look. I chose to hand sew the entire look to be as accurate as possible with the era, seeing as sewing machines weren't around in the 1700s. This process took over 100 hours. The first garment is a shift, which will later be called a chemise. It is the layer closest to the skin and would be washed the most often. It's a loose garment and the pattern is mostly rectangles with a gore at the sides to widen the skirt. I'm making mine out of a linen fabric. The seams are sewn together with a mantua maker seam, which contains the raw edges while also creating the seam. It's important to bind the raw edges of seams, especially with a shift, since it will save the garment from fraying through its future of frequent washes. The final touches include hemming the skirt, neckline, and sleeves. Also, I've decided to monogram the front, which was often done to identify whose was whose when garments were washed together. Next comes the underpetticoat, which helps fill out the skirt. It's a very basic construction, and it's the easiest out of all the garments. The material I chose was a heavy hemp fabric. A rectangle piece is cut, and then the short edges are sewn together, leaving an opening at the waist. The bottom edge is hemmed, and then large pleats gather up the waist, and then twill tape is used to bind that top raw edge and also create the ties. And now for the funniest part of this ensemble, we have a false rump. That's what it's called. This creates volume in the back, much like a bustle of the 1880s. This particular style is called a split rump and flatters the style of the Italian gown, which is what I'm making. The base piece is a rectangle and helps stabilize the pillows once they're attached. The edges are all hemmed and then the waist is pleated up. Made of two pieces sewn together, the pillows are slightly narrower at the top and then have rounded corners at the bottom. The top is left open for stuffing. But first, one edge is pleated and attached to the skirt apron piece. For stuffing, I've placed the unstuffed rump on the dress form so I can keep track of the size as I go. It was fashionable to have your hips be double the size of your waist. I chose an old down pillow for my volume, but it's not a very fun task. Let's just say feathers up the nose is not very pleasant. Once the desired measurement was achieved, I could finally trap the feathers inside and get the second edge pinned and sewn in place. The last step is using a piece of twill tape to bind the raw edges and again to create the ties. This next piece is the most time-consuming of the process, taking over 50 hours to create. It is the stays. They are the structure and support of the Georgian era, much like corsets are for the 1900s. These are made of three layers, two of the heavy hemp fabric and an outer layer of cotton twill, which used to have a beautiful embossed design on it, but then I threw it in the wash. It was not grand. Goodbye to the embossing, but it's still a good fabric to use for the outer layer, even if it's not as pretty as it was. All the layers are cut out, the sewing lines marked, and then basted together. Next comes placing all the boning channels. These are marked with chalk, and then a back stitch is placed right on the markings going through all the layers. This is creating the channel. And I might add, it was a very time-consuming and tedious process considering there's 60 bones placed throughout these stays. am using a linen thread for this project, which is wax to strengthen it and keep it from fraying. The center back pieces are then prepped for the next step of hand sewing 22 eyelets. I now have all my pieces prepped and they can be assembled. This is done using an interesting technique, folding the seam allowances in and then using a whip or overcast stitch to secure the two folded edges of the seam. Once those seams are sewn, which is not a very easy process considering all the thick fabrics that are being worked with, the couple pieces of boning that's right next to the seams are put in, and then leather is used for welting. I found it very interesting that leather was used for this, as well as binding the edges. I think it's ingenious. I'm using a leather chamois and cutting 1/4-inch strips for the welting. This is sewn on top of the seams for decoration and to hide the seams. All the rest of the boning is then inserted, and the seam allowances are tacked down with a catch stitch. Finally, it's time to bind all these edges. This is done with a wider strip of leather. Of course, this includes all the tabs along the bottom, which was not a fast task. A couple more eyelets for the straps are sewn, and the final step is lining. This is done with a lightweight linen. Now, with 50 hours of sewing quite heavy-duty fabric, my fingers were very worn out and extremely sore, but the main part is done. Yes, I consider this to be the main piece of the ensemble. It creates all the shape and the structure of the era and also took the most amount of time. Now, having said that, the irony is that nothing that's been made thus far will be visible. But we're finally onto that with the silk petticoat. More like partial silk petticoat. I didn't have enough silk to make the full thing, so I pieced together the back with a somewhat matching cotton fabric, which will be hidden by the dress. This was all pieced together with Montua Maker seams. Along the hem, a pinked ruffle is attached for decoration. The waist is then pleated up, starting at center front with a large box pleat, and then smaller pleats going off in each direction. The waist has two slits or openings, one on each side. This allows for a pocket or two to be tied around the waist, and then through these openings and ones in the dress, you can reach your pockets. The petticoat is placed on a dress form with the false rump underneath, and the waist is then arranged so that an even hem is achieved. And finally, it's time for the dress. I used a replica cotton fabric from Colonial Williamsburg. The skirt is made of several rectangle panels with a slightly curved hem. The bodice has two layers, the main fabric, and then a lining of linen. For the back pieces, the construction is a bit different than a standard bodice construction. It's using English seams, which sews all the edges of both the lining and the outer fabric together in one pass. It is such a neat seam. Hands down, my favorite seam I've learned on this project. From there, the front piece is also attached in a unique way. Just the lining is attached to the back pieces, and then a fit check is done. The seam with just the lining is sewn, and then the fashion fabric is placed over those raw edges and shaped to match the back seams. This is then sewn in place with a square stitch. Next comes the sleeves, which have a dart, which allow movement in the elbow. Since the sleeves are a tight style, it took a lot to get a good fit, but finally I got it and could attach them. The lower part is sewn like a regular seam, but then the top is much like that side seam. The sleeve is sewn in place, and then the fashion shoulder strap is placed on top of it and sewn
with a square stitch.
For the skirt, all the panels are sewn together with a Montua Maker seam and then pleated up. The bodice is then laid on top and sewn into place, going into just the bodice edge and then through all the pleats. That extra fabric at the waist is just folded down and not trimmed. This is to add extra volume to the bustle look. Final touches include a rolled hem and then a tie and loop to draw up the skirt in the back. With over 100 hours of hand-sewn work, this 18th century ensemble is complete. If you'd like to see the process of donning all these pieces, you can find a Get Ready With Me video on my channel. You can also find in-depth, full-length vlog tutorials on making each of these pieces. Thanks for watching, and remember to learn always, create with passion, and inspire others.